One of the world's most storied and respected management consulting firms is finding itself in the subject of critical media scrutiny, much of it coming from the New York Times and my other employer. McKinsey has faced a slew of negative press over the past year from troubles in South Africa, potentially profiting on the outcome of Puerto Rico's debt crisis, taking heat for its work with Saudi Arabia. At one point, the firm was called the new Facebook, and it was likely not intended as a compliment. Why the sudden scrutiny, and what is the company going to do about it? Joining us right now is McKinsey's global managing partner, Kevin Zeter, for the first on CNBC interview. And we're very happy to have you here.
Thank you for having me.
Let's go through these headlines, though, and try to understand what's happened, because it does feel like there is something rotten going on. When you hear about these massive corruption scandals going on in South Africa, the situation with Saudi, where you were identifying dissidents, which then were ultimately targeted by the government, the fine by the Justice Department over on the bankruptcy front. I mean, do you think there's a problem here?
Well, here's the thing. I am one of the people at McKinsey who I think has three things to do. One is to look very hard at what's happening, understand it, learn from it, and act. And that's what I'm determined to do. Behind each of those stories, of course, there's more to it than meets the eye. And I could spend a lot of time explaining to you the whys and the wherefores and how really to think about those headlines. But what's important, I think, in all of this, and I certainly recognize, is one of the great strengths of our firm in the past was its sense of mystery. In fact, I remember one of the first articles that covered us when I joined the firm was the McKinsey Mystique. And I think there was a period of time when mystique was a good thing. Mystique's not a good thing anymore. People don't like secrecy, and we have to change with that. I recognize that. There's not a lot of mystique about me. I grew up in Glasgow. I understand why people feel that it's time to change, and I sense that our firm senses that too.
What does that mean? For example, you have done business with authoritarian governments for a very long time. You have often run to the fire when others would run away from it, if you will. Do you plan to say, you know what, we're not doing business with Saudi Arabia anymore?
Well, let me just take issue a bit with what you've just said, because I think one of the things we have done is to make sure that we work on the kind of topics that I think are positive for the world. And even in Saudi Arabia, where clearly there's lots of concern on the part of many business leaders, many political leaders, the whole world is focused in on what's happening there. Not everyone is running from Saudi Arabia, in fact, far from it. And what we do in Saudi Arabia, I think we make a positive contribution. We have, for example, we're one of the largest employers of professional women in the country. That makes a difference. We've done work in education, economic development, the kind of things that give hope that youth will be employed in that country. The world does not want Saudi Arabia to descend into a place where there aren't jobs and where it gets really tough in a very nasty way.
You can't change things if you're not there. Do you think that the New York Times has treated you fairly?
I've thought hard about that question, and I think, regrettably, I think the answer is no. I think they've been unfair. That doesn't mean I don't accept and, frankly, respect and welcome the scrutiny.
I mean, you saw Jill Abramson's book, part that she wrote herself, where she said that the entire coverage
I don't want to turn this into a referendum on the paper.
It doesn't matter whether you want it or not.
Kevin, your point just there that you can't, and Joe's point within it, that you can't help make changes on education or women's rights in the workplace in Saudi Arabia if you're not there doing it. Does that justify taking fees from an otherwise bad actor in other areas?
Well, I don't think I look at it as terms of taking fees from a bad actor, because the work that we do, and we think very hard about the work that we do, needs to be work that does make a positive difference.
Sure.
And that's what I'm focused on.
But just straight up and down, doing business with a murderer is okay by you?
No, it's absolutely not.
Okay, and when you find out that your client is a murderer, you do what?
You walk. If your client is a murderer, and that's why when we think about where we work and what we work on.
Okay, so let's talk about Saudi Arabia then.
Sure.
What happened?
Well, what we're doing and what we've been very thoughtful about is the kind of work that we take. And the kind of work that we take, we put some careful boundaries around it. Let's be clear. So we don't work for the Ministry of Defense. We don't work for the Interior Ministry. In fact, the sad thing about all of this, and you referenced it in the opening, the identification of dissidents, that isn't what we were doing. We were doing, I think, mistakenly an attempt to justify how to apply analytics. We didn't identify
people. Kim Jong-un has murdered anyone, Andrew? Has Kim Jong-un has Putin, has President Xi, has anyone in Iran?
Yes,
we did a nuclear deal with Iran.
There's a larger question going on in the world right now for business
executives
across the world about the new boundaries.
You think you can ask a black and white question about
that is the question that we're all wrestling with. let's be clear, and we're wrestling with that, but we're not alone.
But let's live in the real world.
And that's one of the real world questions.
And think about what our interests are long term in the real world versus some type of utopian virtue signaling.
But that's a fair point, Joe.
Okay, then don't deal with Xi. Don't deal with North Korea. Don't deal with Iran. Don't have any contact with any country where someone's been murdered. We murder people here with capital punishment. What if they have different laws, different values?
Okay, let me say, that's a fair point, but then the pushback shouldn't be to say that we think
who's cut off relations? What company has cut off relations with Saudi Arabia?
We do good work with the bad actors.
Has BlackRock, has any company cut off relations with Saudi Arabia and lived up to your virtuous, how you would handle it, Andrew?
Let me ask our guest a separate question.
Please do.
A large part of your business is, at least the operations of your business, has long been about recruiting and hiring young people from some of the best universities around the world to come work there, oftentimes for several years before they go up to business school. I mean, that is a huge part of the model. And given that millennials, frankly, Joseph, actually seem to care about some of these issues in a way that you may not.
They're taking us down some great paths, Andrew.
Yeah, I want to understand how you think this has affected your ability to recruit young people who I think care about these issues about purpose, care about whether you're working with murderers.
And I care too. And let's be crystal clear. We recruit about 8,000 people every year, and we receive 800,000 applications for those 8,000 jobs. So it doesn't matter how they see us. And of course, we want people who have strong views, who have opinions, who have perspectives. We actually want to engage with them in a dialogue to answer the challenge that business has of how do you operate in this very complicated world? Let me give you one short anecdote.
Okay.
I often call recruits, and I often talk to them when they've got opportunities to go to other places. I recently called a young woman who had a resume. When I read it, I thought we were the Peace Corps, because I read her, it was pristine in terms of all the causes you could possibly support. And the conversation began, she said, Kevin, I want to let you know why I'm going to take your offer over three alternatives. It's because you're actually talking about these issues. You're debating them. You're trying to understand how to navigate them. We're not alone in trying to navigate this set of topics. Mm-hmm. But what she was convinced, and I'm convinced, is that we're going to do it very thoughtfully, and we are going to get to a good answer. And that's why when I think about places in the world where it is difficult to operate, you have a choice. Of course, you can declare everything off-site and off-limits, or you can get in there and think about, how do we navigate? What are the checks?
Let me ask you a navigation question.
Yeah.
So there was a recent story in the Times about an investment fund that McKinsey has, I know you would argue, separate from...
Completely separate.
From the firm. But by default, by having an investment fund at the same time that you consult with so many different businesses, at the very least, it creates a perception issue that there is a conflict. Why have that fund? Why don't you say to yourself, you know what? We can use an outside firm like BlackRock or some other firm that can manage money on behalf of McKinsey Partners.
Of course, that's a question we're asking. But let me remind you, the reason we had it in the first place was because McKinsey Partners cannot invest in individual stocks. It's there because it's one of the ways to ensure there is no risk of anyone profiting from the advice that we give. And that's why the fund was set up way back when. Now, when we look at it, we have to think about perception. Of course we do. So that's one of the considerations I need to take, and others need to take as well.
Why do you think, going back to the point you said earlier, Kevin, that others are having similar battles, the focus is so much on McKinsey at the moment when, as we all know, a lot of people pulled out of the Saudi Arabia conference last year, but a lot of banks still do bond issuance, they still advise the sovereign wealth fund, still take fees, but the focus is on you. Do you think there has been a little bit more that you've done that warrants that, or it's just that you're in the eye of the storm at the moment?
I think it's a bit of everything. I think, as I said at the beginning, there's a bit of mystique that people want to burst, and we made some mistakes. I also think, in reality, we're paying a price for being less transparent, less open about who we are. One of the reasons I was keen to come here is to show a face and say, actually, McKinsey is full of people who have very humble backgrounds, who are at McKinsey because they want to serve others. Mm-hmm. If you actually think about what we do, and one of the things I always say to our recruits, if you want to be the star quarterback and be in the sunshine and be paid the big bucks, go to Wall Street. If you want to be the coach who helps other people succeed, who doesn't take the glory, come to us and get your satisfaction from seeing others do well. Full of people like that.
Over the next 12 months, what do you think the big changes are that we're going to see? I know you said you're thinking about different things, but in terms of hard and fast things that people will point to and say, you know what, this firm actually has changed.
Well, I think they're going to see three things. One, they're going to see us be quite thoughtful and even more thoughtful than we've been around who we serve and who we don't serve. So some choices there which we are currently working through, and very soon we'll be in a place where we've made those choices. Secondly, I think you're going to see us be a lot more open. I want us to be engaging with the outside world. I mean, frankly, I think that is part of why it's so easy to write about us, because we're a sitting target. We don't talk about what we do, we don't celebrate what we do, and we don't ask our clients to talk about what we do. Yet every day of the week, 5,500 McKinsey teams go out there and serve their clients, do great work, which is why our clients are standing by us. And the third thing, I'd like us to be very explicit about the full impact of our work. I've been at McKinsey for 30 years, and over that time, we've created jobs, we've brought innovation, we've made change happen. I want us to be able to describe that.
Where do you think you went wrong, though? Where do you think, and the reason is, I think it's hard to not look, though, at the situation and say, look, when you get fined by the Justice Department for $15 million and you get, you know, you get called out for lack of disclosure around certain things, that's an issue, especially when effectively the business is, you're in the judgment business, right? That is the business.
Well, let me be crystal clear. I haven't denied that we made some mistakes, and I hope you've heard me loud and clear and say we did. I don't take issue with the notion we made some mistakes. What I believe is at the heart of that is indeed this notion of being even more thoughtful about who we serve. When you're in a firm like ours, our desire to help people is absolutely what motivates. It's not money, it's not greed.
Are there certain clients you think that you're gonna drop?
I think over time we will have to rethink what we do, the particular topics we work on, and indeed some of the clients we serve. But we serve thousands of clients, and can I just make one obvious point? Yeah. A lot of what's been written is actually about work that was done literally decades ago. And in that context, if you think about the sheer number of clients we serve, I think perspective is important and context matters too. But that doesn't mean I don't take the mistakes we made seriously. It doesn't mean we're not listening and learning. We are. And I'm determined to act and make the most of this. Because the one thing I can tell you, McKinsey, we've been around since 1926. We created a profession that didn't exist. And we have to get this right.
If we have a majority of millennials that think socialism is a more effective way to govern rather than capitalism, do I need to consider how they feel in every decision I make at McKinsey? I've seen McKinsey stories from the New York Times actually disparaging you because you're trying to help companies actually maximize profits. And that would make sense if I take the millennial view of forms of government, and where suddenly I believe that socialism, just because they feel that way, Andrew, I don't need to take their feelings into account if it's something I believe strongly in terms of capitalism. So I'm not going to sit here and walk on.
If you're going to hire 8,000 people, young people, every single year, I imagine that you have to take the
right. But I would also hope that you would be fair and that media writ large would be more fair in covering a lot of things that instead of being written by people who believe in socialism. That's a tough one, I know for you.
One thought on that. I grew up in Glasgow. It's a pretty, it's actually a socialist town in many, many ways. But one of the first memories I have in McKinsey, because I want to make sure we actually understand who we are, is some work we did, which was about how to help a city, my hometown, that was on its knees. Shipbuilding had closed, the steel mills were shutting, the coal mines had gone. And the work we did was how do we regenerate the inner city of Glasgow? It wasn't a philanthropic piece. It was a genuine effort to coalesce a view as to how you regenerate a city. That work changed my city. Wilf, probably you don't remember, it's before your time. Glasgow's miles better, came out of it. It changed the destiny of a whole lot of people. We do good work. That's lost in this conversation. I am very able to look the millennials in the eye that you talk about, just as we have done, and it's why our recruiting is going fine, thank you, and say to them, you come to our firm, we actually make a huge difference, one client at a time. That's been what we've been doing. We need to get it right, stop the mistakes, of course, yet I'm realistic to recognize it's tough to do that completely, but we will try, and at the same time show people that actually business is a very important contributor to society. Right.
Structurally, just internally, what are the biggest changes you have made or plan to make in terms of conflicts, in terms of disclosure?
We've made a number of changes. Obviously, one of the things, if you take the conflicts issue, we went into that arena because clients at their most desperate hour wanted help from people like us. And we did it with lots of advice that said, if you disclose in this way, it's appropriate and it's okay. We stuck to that advice. If it's now the case that that no longer holds true, of course we change and we respond, and that's what we're going to do. So we are not going to fly in the face of advice as to what we need to require. We will comply. But let me be crystal clear. We didn't go in naively. We did go in with good advice, and we're determined to be on the right side of these issues.